Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Berks Perspectives. We're ready to go again, and I am Fred Levering, joined by Martha Richardson.
Hi, everybody.
And John Forrester.
Hello.
Tom Gallagher from Points on the Other Side of the Planet, and Fred Opalinski, nearly on the other side of the planet, but only over in Lebanon County, right?
Same time zone.
Well, as always, there's a lot going on, and we haven't spent a great deal of time on it lately, so I wanted to start out with Ukraine. Tom, I'm getting a sense from what I've been hearing that Russia is on the verge of winning. I don't know that I'd want to say they're completely ready to overrun anything, but they seem to be getting some momentum that was previously pretty much a stalemate. So, Tom, what are your thoughts on it at the moment?
Well, I don't think that's accurate, and I'm curious where you're getting that, because I haven't seen that anywhere. I would say that Ukraine is losing at the moment. It is giving up ground, Avdiivka in particular. But the thing is that and I think I've used this example before, this estimate was something like, if at the rate of troop loss, if it happened on a per kilometer basis based on what they've been able to take since Bakhmut last winter and Avdiivka this winter, the Russians would lose 2 million troops just to get to Kyiv. So it's a big ask on that side of things that it would. But the frustrating thing is that this is such an easy thing to not lose, but yet we're working really, really hard at losing this, because basically the capabilities are there. These losses are just occurring because there's artillery shortages, there's all these different things, because foreign sources for these things are not delivering. You know, the EU had promised 1 million rounds of 155 millimeter ammo by this March. So far, 80,000 rounds have been delivered. So it's just kind of going like, the question is that people are talking in political circles about how important this is, but they're not putting actual energy and plans behind it. I'll give a good example of this. So there was an interview with one of the EC, European Commission people, forgetting his first name, he's a Frenchman, Michel, and he was talking about there is no plan B other than the plan A, which is for Ukrainian victory. He says, as far as Europe is concerned, there is no plan B. Well, plan A is a policy position, as he has it. It's not a plan. A plan would be, let's get 300 multi-role fighters, 1,000 tanks and armored personnel carriers, 1 million rounds of 155 millimeters, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All that sort of stuff. That would be a plan. But nobody's putting that out there, and nobody's putting a price tag on it. And I'm afraid that even if the $60 billion gets through from the U.S., it's just going to be this piecemeal, completely disjunct sort of handout that goes there without an idea of how are we going to win. And we still have not heard the Biden administration say their policy position is Ukrainian victory. You know, and this is one of the biggest problems that we have, is that, you know, a military establishment needs a mission, they need clearly defined goals, and we have not seen that from anybody. So one can really seriously question whether or not what the Biden administration's position is not Ukrainian victory, but capitulation under a certain position. And I think there's a lot of argument there to be saying that that's actually what the Biden administration is doing. And the EU, they're talking about being proud that they're getting the 2% on spending of what the NATO members are supposed to spend on defense. If you've been behind that 2% for decades, you have depleted stockpiles. Just achieving it for 1 year is no great shakes.
Yeah.
You could be doing that on personnel.
Well, there just seems to be an element of fatigue setting in. I mean, the losses have been staggering. I mean, the most recent thing I read was that the casualties on the Russian side could be around 300,000 and about 100,000 Ukrainians. That's just devastating kind of stuff.
The casualty numbers on the Russian side are well over 400,000. If you mean injured and killed, I would say that the actual killed is approaching the 400,000 side. I would say that the Ukrainian losses on the field are probably over 200,000. So they're sizable numbers, but we still have. I mean, it's you cannot draft somebody under the age of 25. So there are a whole bunch of young men in Ukraine hanging out who are not going to be drafted until they hit 25. It used to be 27. Now it's there. And this is Ukraine trying to preserve its demographic advantage going into the future, because they have to think about the long term. In a country with no young adults that are going to have families and all sorts of things, is going to be in a really, really big trouble. Part of my point is that if the U.S. and NATO came to Ukraine saying, this is the plan that we're going to do to win, this is what you guys need to do, the fatigue and the things that you're seeing there, Fred, which are real, those are real elements, it's mostly there because people don't know what the task is. And we saw this in Afghanistan with the U.S. For 20 years, after the first year, there was no mission. There was no goal for them. You know, and this makes work for militaries extremely difficult. So, yeah, they're going to lose that. And if you don't have people circulating in, and this is one of the problems that Ukraine has, you're trying to get blood out of the same stone over and over again.
Well, and you've got Putin, who has demonstrated his evil over and over again, now poking at us even more with the death of Navalny, the arrest of the ballet dancer today. Mm-hmm. It's as though he's sort of puffing up his chest and saying, nah, nah, you can't get me, and there's nothing more you can do, and so I'm just going to play this for all it's worth to show his stuff by image. And how we can stand by and let that happen is just beyond understanding.
Well, go ahead, Martha.
Well, I was just going to say, Ukraine has become a less new shiny object for the news sources. It's now, you have to kind of page into the New York Times to get any kind of real in-depth information on the Ukraine, and that wasn't the case until other things started to become newer, brighter objects to focus on with 24-hour news. And that's very disturbing to me. Because again, I will say what I said when we started talking about this a long time ago, it seems. Get out a map of Europe and look to see. We're not talking about a 23-mile strip of land here. We're talking about a very large chunk of Europe. It has been a functioning democracy that could become a non-functioning democracy as we slide it back from page one to page two, page three. The lack of this country's support is just appalling to me.
I heard a chilling comment today saying that Russia, as it stands now, is just a country. If it gains Ukraine, it's an empire again. And that is no doubt what Putin has in mind. And then after that, what's to stop him with the Baltic countries and who knows, Poland perhaps? I don't know.
I was just also going to say Senator Romney was on the floor of the Senate a week or so ago when he was making comments criticizing Republicans in the House for not taking up the bill that the Senate had sent to them. And he said, you know, you guys have come up with excuses. You know, you have your reasons, but they keep changing. When one no longer holds, you come up with another one for this. And that is very true, is that over this period, people have come up with sham arguments as to why we're not doing things on things this way or that. And I don't think that, any of those things are actually their real true reasons. I think they're just the ones that the public will listen and hold on to. And I do think the affordability one is a complete sham. I mean, it's just, I've thrown these statistics at you guys before, but you know, at 3.5% of GDP, our military spending is at the lowest of anybody's lifetime on this show. And we had 2.2 million people in uniform in 1990 at the end of the Cold War. We have about 800,000 fewer now than we did in 1990, but we have 80 million more people. So how in the world is the military of today at all prepared for a contentious Europe, which was no way anywhere close to what it was like in during the Cold War? And when people start throwing around terms like Cold War 2.0, I think this is just because people have a complete lack of understanding of what's going on. And I do blame our political leadership for this. Nobody is explaining to them how the Hamas attacks on Israel are related to the Russian attacks on Ukraine, and how so much of what we're going to be seeing is continued testing of our position in the world.
And well, now before
that would be understandable.
Before we draw the Middle East in, let's talk a little bit further about Ukraine. John, you've been unusually quiet there in your corner of my screen.
Well, I really don't have much to add, you know, except in answer to Tom's implied question as to why the Republicans keep opposing the bill and changing their argument. I think the argument is our country's national tendency for isolationism, you know, not to get involved in other people's wars.
But realize that, if Ukraine goes down and Putin is emboldened, we may have no choice but to be involved with boots on the ground, lives being lost, and a whole lot more than sending munitions and money. Right?
You're talking harder about why.
Yeah, and I think that John's point is also, I would add on to that, is that they find those people who are being isolationists find that makes them electable. And by speaking in that tone, they will get reelected because people see things that they don't understand, that they don't want to be involved in. And this is where political leadership needs to, we haven't seen it in a long time, come up with explaining complex things to people in a simple way. And, you know, I think that was something that, you know, when we had just had President's Day, that we have to remember that was a hallmark of Abraham Lincoln. You know, he was able to explain to people in a way that they understood why something was important.
Well, and Roosevelt's fireside chats were enormously helpful, explaining the economy and I mean, lots of things in a very simple, down-to-earth way.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, even then, Roosevelt was dealing with the lend-lease, finagling things with the lend-lease program, and you know, kind of doing things by back channels. So it wasn't as simple as his fireside chats.
Well, I
can think of a million reasons. You can think of a million reasons not to do an action, but there's only one reason to do something, and that's to preserve democracy and stem the Russian aggression.
Well, Putin, in addition to the Navalny death, which has been so far accredited to something called sudden death syndrome. I mean, can you believe that they actually say such things? But there was also a Russian helicopter pilot who defected to Ukraine, and Ukraine agreed to give him some kind of anonymous cover or whatever, and it turned out just in the last day or two that he was killed, shot in Spain, where he was living. That his secret identity wasn't so secret, I guess. And Russians apparently took him out. for the audacity of what he did. Now, if I wasn't clear at the beginning, I don't foresee Russia overtaking Ukraine. I mean, the losses, I was pointing out the number of casualties partially to say that would be just overwhelming. The numbers are already pathetic, but that would just be overwhelming. I mean, this we're talking about, from what I understand, from the original, at the beginning of the Ukrainian invasion, the number of troops that Russia had have been depleted before you start to calculate the conscription and so on, like by two-thirds. I mean, it was an enormous percentage of the Russian active army at that point in time that has been simply lost. So I don't believe that they have the appetite to go and try to take over the country. But I do foresee that there's going to be some kind of negotiations that are going to be initiated where Putin will basically keep what he's got so far, you know, Crimea, and then these eastern Ukraine areas that have been taken over. And I don't foresee it going beyond that, Tom.
Well, and it's, I'm glad you clarified that. And I do think that there is an increasingly likely nature that Ukraine is going to be put in that very difficult position. But I think the other thing people should realize is that there was an election, even though the outcome is already known, in Russia on March 17th. And you know, he's basically eliminated anybody who was going to be opposition as well. And I didn't eliminate the one opposition guy who's actually of his same party. He's just an anti-war guy. He was removed from the ballot. This has actually probably affected Russia's desire to conscript people so far. I think that we need to be prepared that in April and May, we're going to see the number of Russian conscripts going up. It's just politically unpopular. And what you were talking about as far as, I forget who actually mentioned about Navalny's death. I think it was Fred Obolensky. Navalny's death and imprisoning people. Actually, Navalny would actually say he's doing it because he's afraid. He's afraid that the people of Russia are catching wind of what's going on, and he has to move to more brutal. I'm surprised Navalny was allowed to be alive this long, to be honest with you. So, I mean, and they did try and kill him before. So, it's just a strange sort of ad hoc way of approaching things. But we do have to look things from a domestic position and, when understanding Putin, and a lot of it is this election. The big push for Avdiivka, which is again the tertiary city in southeastern Ukraine, was considered to be important for electoral purposes. They wanted to give a win to the Russian population, so they did tremendous amounts of meat waves to be able to basically overwhelm Ukrainian forces there. It's not a tactic they could repeat over and over again without conscripting hundreds of thousands of more people. Will that mean that hundreds of thousands of millions of Russians will leave the country? Could be, but it would be more difficult now. They're not supposed to be able to leave so easily.
Well, go ahead, Fred.
I was going to ask, were you surprised that there wasn't a greater outpouring of protests after Navalny's death? I mean, it seemed to be hit and miss, and some hundreds of people were arrested. I was really hoping, this is my naivete maybe, but that there would be massive demonstrations, and that certainly hasn't happened.
Well, I just think that in many cases, they don't want to end up in prison like Navalny. And
if they were in sufficient numbers, they wouldn't end up in prison because...
Yeah, it's who's and this is the way it's got to go. But the people who actually try and orchestrate anything are finding themselves in prison or dead. This has been true in Belarus for years. And this is one of the reasons why Lukashenko has been able to hold Belarus under control and had obvious sham elections. So, I guess I'm not that surprised by it. I think that in many ways they wanted Navalny to be off of people's minds before they did this and make him more of an afterthought. So, yeah, there is hope that more and more people in Russia are just going to find the loss of Russian lives for an un Just like we were talking about Republicans in Congress, Putin's reasons for invading Ukraine have changed over umpteenth times from the beginning to now. You know, the denazification thing, the NATO thing, all these different things. It just spins through and all that. And I think that a large number of the people have to recognize is it's like, yeah, we've kind of heard all of these excuses, but we're not really seeing why that applies in this case.
So I don't know what the occasion was, but not within the last week or so, Putin referred to himself as the defender of traditional Christian values. Mm-hmm. It just makes me sick to my stomach, and that people are buying that and believing it with this murderous thug. Anyway, it's just another part of the story.
Especially when we all know that the Redeemer is
right here
States and running for president of the United States.
Well, now, on that note, Tom, you had alluded and began to make a comment about tying the Ukrainian issue into Gaza and people's lack of understanding of it. So now pick up on that thought and take it into our next segment here.
Okay, so Russia's biggest ally and most reliable ally across the board on things is Iran. And Iran has been providing, I mean, China has certainly been supporting Russia in numerous ways, but they've been doing it with limitations, knowing that they're being watched. Well, if you're Iran, you're already under sanctions, you're already in trouble, you're basically already the bad boy, nobody cares, you're not gonna put yourself in worse standing and all that. And this they saw as their opportunity. Working with Russia, they saw their opportunity. And I believe that the Hamas attack, timed when it was pretty much put forward and backed by Iran to do it. And it was to create a distraction for the West away from Ukraine. And I think the other basis of the Hamas attack was they knew that would create a dilemma for the Israeli Defense Force. They have to respond, but in responding, they're going to kill civilians. Killing civilians is going to make Israel look less popular. So there's almost nothing that Israel could do end of the situation with this full-on attack of 1,700 people being murdered. So I think that it's important that people realize that these things are being coordinated at a larger level, recognizing who the antagonists are, and that's us, and trying to string us out, wears down emotionally, thinking like, why are we getting constantly involved in these troubles so that we can feel distance and avoid them. But also feel like, well, this one's more important than that one, and get divided over it. I do think that we also have to go back to this idea that Putin wants to create a division within NATO. And Iran would love to see that too, but it doesn't apply in Iran's case so much. But they want to see divisions in NATO, and they're going to test NATO. They're going to test NATO's Article 5 to actually see if they will do that. And I think we have to be prepared for that next 5 to 10 years. The Article 5 will be tested, and whether or not all members of NATO are going to fall in line is going to be interesting to see. I am not so sure that they would. Gesundheit, John.
Thank you.
Well, Gesundheit from halfway around the world. So the funding for both Israel and Ukraine are still up in the air. There doesn't seem to be any particular, I hate to say it, but urgency. I mean, it seems like this should have been done a long time ago, and the fact that it's still dragging along. The other thing that just strikes me is the interconnectedness, or whatever you want to call it, around the world right now of almost everything. There was a Iranian manufactured missile that was fired by the Russians into Ukraine that was shot down, but it wasn't completely destroyed. And they picked the remnants of that thing apart and found components in that missile that Iran built and sent to Russia from North Korea, from the United States. There were chips or whatever components in that missile that were from all over the place. I mean, it's incredible, isn't it? It struck me as incredible.
And you're right, and it's one of the reasons why sanctions are so difficult to enforce. Mm-hmm. Because, right. You know, when you're talking about semiconductor chips, you can sell that to somebody in Turkey, and Turkey's completely open customer for that. Well, then Turkey could sell it to Afghanistan, and Afghanistan to Iran. You know, so we're finding U.S. components in Russian munitions all the time. Most missiles, when they're downed, are actually, there's lots of parts of it actually that still remain, and you can go through the components, and all of them have serial numbers on it. Mm-hmm. And some of these things have been manufactured in the last 6 months.
All right. Yeah.
So it's not like stuff that occurred before 2022.
Nope. It's a remarkable thing. You pointed out the difference with Iran, and that's, I mean, they're the folks that just I can't quite understand. I mean, the say what you will about the Russians, but I still think the Russians love their children. I'm not so sure about the Iranians. I mean, their actions and the jihadist point of view of everybody is an infidel, and honestly believing if they die a martyr's death, they're going to go sit in the right hand of Allah and all that stuff. I don't know how you deal with those people. As you travel around, Tom, what do other people around the world think about that threat?
You know, there's a very good question, but I think the answer that I would give would be disappointing, that most people do not really have a strong education on international geopolitics, international relations geopolitics. I think I related last week that you know, people have a real strong relationship to the strongman idea. They catch on to very simple ideas with that. Now with Iran, I think most of them, and with Russia, to be honest, I think most people see them as a sinister actor. But in many ways, I think that they see them as just a necessary evil to deal with, particularly with Russia because of its resources and exports, et cetera, which, mind you, is actually not the largest in the world, but it's a significant part of the world. So, I think that much of the world will side against colonial powers that they just usually have a thing with from the beginning. So in much of Africa, you'll see a lot of people who have an anti-French or an anti-British bias to start with. And so they're very quick to take on positions that, you know, these are that the French or the British are supporting Israel and the killing of Palestinians. That just appeals to them without having, you know, any thought or any further investigation into that. So people, it's justification of the bias that you will often see.
Well, in regards to the Israeli invasion, you know, invasion of Gaza and pushing back, and just Netanyahu is not showing any signs, regardless of what anybody else has to say, about stopping. And the ceasefires and so on are constantly being talked about. Hamas is never, I don't think, negotiated in good faith as far as the hostages are concerned. But some of the things I've been reading of late, you know, are indicating that some of the details in regards to the initial Hamas attack on Israel, the hostage taking is one thing, but the atrocities, some of the things that I've read about just make your blood boil. I mean, it's just horrible. And when Netanyahu says the only answer is to completely wipe them out, I mean, I get it. That view isn't necessarily shared. John's shaking his head. John?
Yeah, well, first of all, war, the one of the great political tactics is go to war. I mean, that's going to keep you in office. No matter what. I don't know that we've ever voted out a wartime president, or any democracy has gotten rid of a wartime government. After the wars, they've done that, but you kind of don't change horses in the middle of the string. So Netanyahu is going to keep Israel at war as long as it keeps him out of in office and out of jail. And that's why he's doing that. I don't know that we should buy the description of the atrocities of October 4th October 5th 7th. Lock, stock, and barrel, and you know, hook, line, sinker, and onshore. Yes, it was a terrible attack. It was an unwarranted attack. It was 1,700 lives snuffed out in a matter of hours. However, you know, how many lives have been lost so far in Gaza? I mean, and this is all being perpetuated, generated, perpetuated, and distributed to keep this alive and keep it going. And I have a feeling it's going to be playing a huge role in our presidential election.
Well, I really can't agree with Netanyahu. I believe that his pushback has a lot to do with, unless you wipe them out, which I don't think is exactly possible, of course, but right. Without wiping them out, you're just delaying the next attack. I mean, they're just going to reconstitute, and therefore, that's their thinking.
I think there's truth to both what Fred and John are saying there, and I think that on John's side of things, that we have to actually go back to, that's actually one of the reasons why Putin invaded Ukraine, is that he had been seeing his popularity among young voters in Russia degraded, and this was one of those ways of actually being able to cement power, was to become that wartime president. The thing about Iran is their regime has seen what's happened to Gaddafi and has happened to Saddam Hussein, and their efforts in doing all these, being the great disruptor of society that they are, is to not end up like them. And it's self-preservation. It has nothing to do with the people of Iran. What's better for them is about keeping the people in power. And this is so much the case. This is the case of Maduro in Venezuela. It's just, you play this out with dictators, authoritarians around, has nothing to do with the local people. Coming back to the Hamas situation is that, and I ask this to anybody, that attack on October 7th that Hamas put together, what was it meant to achieve? What was it going to do? Was it going to say, have Israelis say, well, we can't take this, we gotta go? It had no goal and objective other than to bring up the swarm of bees, to poke the bear, to create a reaction that was going to kill, and they had no idea about the exact numbers, but thousands of Palestinians. Hamas clearly had to know that what they were doing was going to create death and destruction to their fellow Palestinians. Now, take that as you might, whatever way you want, but I think it's very hard to think that, you know, guys with paragliders, a handful of homemade missiles, these were going to, you know, make people, they knew what the reaction they were going to get from that. So I do think that Palestinians have to really look at deeply in their soul, not that they could easily do it right now, and actually wonder who really is to blame for the situation they find themselves in.
And if you're right that it was a Russian Moscow generated idea that was carried out by Iran and its subsidiaries, why was it only Hamas that attacked Israel? Why wasn't it coordinated with the other Iranian.
Hezbollah in Lebanon, for example.
Hezbollah is up north in Lebanon. They're armed to the teeth. They could have coordinated it with that. They could have coordinated with the Houthis. But we still didn't see an incredible Hezbollah reaction. It was only a couple thousand kids from Gaza, with pea shooters.
Yeah.
Well, always remember the point of terrorism is to change people's behavior, and you want to make people react, live their lives differently, always looking over their shoulder. And that's why it doesn't take an invasion as much as it takes an attack like this.
Well, there's no doubt Israel is losing the PR war in a big, big way.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's causing divisions, as I said, in this political divisions in this country that didn't previously exist, and I think the Democrats are suffering from it, and the anti-Semites are gathering steam to oppose Israel, and this is a bad situation all around.
Well, let's follow up on that and segue over to the upcoming elections. Now we're well into campaign season. It looks like we're going to have Biden versus Trump 2.0 or something, but when you say, John, that you expect the Gaza situation to play a large role in the upcoming elections, to explain that more.
Yeah, well, the Democrats largely have depended on the young vote and the urban New York Jewish fundraising vote, and they're gonna be if they that's part of why Biden's not calling for the ceasefire. He's not really getting involved in this whole thing very much, except to give them their normal stipend of munitions and weapons. And he's losing a lot of support among the young people because of the perceived anti-Palestinian objection. So this favors the Republicans. It favors Trump, who's largely kept quiet about this.
Fred O, you're sitting there very much. I can see the thoughts rolling around in your forehead.
No, that was exactly what I was going to say, that young people in significant numbers are very upset about the carnage in Gaza and the apparent U.S. support of it, and or maybe not apparent, the support of it. And I think that's a big concern. I think Biden understands the nuance of this. He understands the need to support Israel and at the same time not see this traumatic bloodshed in Gaza. Trump doesn't have an iota of nuance, and so he sort of avoids the whole issue completely, and doesn't comment on it. But it is a very difficult situation to be in for Biden and for the Democrats. I agree. It's bewildering. If I were an advisor, I wouldn't know what to advise. But to see I think the loss of life in Gaza is now up to close to 30,000 people. And that is incredibly disproportionate to that October 7th attack, let alone the destruction of the entire region on top of that.
Martha, you've been way too quiet.
I know, bothers you. I do that. It's like, I always think that I'm like Joshua going around Jericho when I'm really quiet. You know, he marched his troops around very quietly, and then all of a sudden they went boo, and the city was so freaking scared that they just fell apart. So that's me. Think of me as Joshua.
And are we Jericho? That's what I want to know.
No, just Fred. Just Fred. I hate to make this sound so frivolous, but I mean, I was talking about bright, shiny objects. And so, you know, what did Trump do? He introduced a bright, shiny object, golden sneakers. I mean, that was his contribution to the weekend news feed, the golden sneakers, and it worked. This election is just becoming the worst comic book ever, in my opinion.
Well, Nikki Haley has become very sharply critical of Trump, and everything she says about him, I think, is true. And yet, if he is the nominee, she's going to vote for him. I heard Chris Sununu today, really, you know, cheering her on, and thinking that she still has a chance, and she may make some significant contribution. And yet, when asked, he said, "Of course, I would vote for Trump because he's going to be my party's candidate." I mean, it's just bewildering. These people understand how dangerous, what a crazy man he is, self-serving. He has been convicted twice. He's got 91 indictments on their way. And yet, we'll vote for him because he's our guy. Even though they realize that everything about him is disgusting. I don't get it.
Well, I think with Nikki Haley, the reason why she says that element still is to keep the Republican Party something that she still has a lifeline to. If she falls out of line with that, well, then they're going to punish her in whatever way they could. I mean, I don't think she has much of a chance. What's interesting in some of the polling stuff is that she actually shows in polling in a general election against Biden actually winning, whereas Trump does not. And it's just one of these things where you're going like, okay, this is interesting, is that if the Republicans were to put Nikki Haley in there, they'd have a much better chance of winning than if they put in Trump. That doesn't seem to matter to them.
One further with this Chris Sununu interview today that was, I thought, was really disturbing. When the reporter pushed him on the comparison between Trump and Biden, I mean, he didn't deny that Trump was dreadful. What he said was, yeah, but if Biden were elected, we also get Kamala Harris. And that was his real area of concern. I mean, how in the world can you even think that she would be a worse choice than Trump, given
yesterday the list came out of, I assume, that Trump announced who his potential candidates would be for vice president. And
oh, I hadn't
it was
heard that.
And I wish I'd saved it because I don't have the list, but it was kind of, it ended with the woman who's from Hawaii, who was a Democrat,
Tulsi
changed
Gabbard.
Her. Yeah, she was at the bottom of the list as one of his potential candidates. Should be interesting. It was quite a list of people I wouldn't vote for.
Yeah, that was during an interview with Laura Ingraham on Fox, and he really kind of prevaricated on the, you know, when she listed the people, and he just kind of said, oh, I want somebody with common sense because nobody's making it.
I don't have it.
Right. Somebody needs that.
Well, I'm sorry to say this to you, Fred, but isn't the reason that Kamala Harris is an issue is because of Biden's fragility?
Oh, yeah, I get that. But I mean, even, by golly, I can't, how do I want to put it? Kamala Harris is no threat to democracy. Kamala Harris has not been indicted for 91 indictments. Kamala Harris has not been accused or convicted of sexually assaulting someone. I mean, it goes on, and Kamala Harris has not been convicted of fraud. I mean, there's just that anybody could think that she is more dangerous somehow is, I don't understand it.
Well, I agree with you on that, but I think what this really comes from is what I remember back into the 90s, that when Hillary Clinton was first lady, and the assault on her on a daily basis from the talking heads on radio, the feminazi label, all these different things, is that before she had even done anything, she was in their sights. And people who are on the news networks that are, you know, watching this with Chris Sununu and Donald Trump, they're getting these things for years. And this, I think, is really one of those critical things that's going back with the Hunter Biden and the Joe Biden thing, now that they've actually indicted the primary informant for lying and also being a Russian information agent. People are really reluctant to actually drop this case, even though they have no evidence. And Georgia just came out within the electoral fraud thing about, you know, forcing this one organization saying that people were stuffing ballots to provide the evidence. The court said you must provide it. And they said, you know what, we don't have anything. This has been going on for 6 years, this organization is doing this. And I was just like, and yet, if you've been watching those news networks, it's very hard for you to believe that the Biden crime family is not a crime family. You know, that's just where they come from. And what they think of Kamala Harris is based on all the awful things you and I have never heard of, because it wouldn't be newsworthy to us. It probably wouldn't influence us one way or the other. And so I think that this is why we're seeing that. And people throw that out there because, yeah, we're bad Republicans, but don't vote for those Democrats. They're even worse than us.
Well, you're going to get sick of me saying this, but I think it's part of the problem that all these arguments are made on the edges and nothing in the middle. You know, we got everybody wants to cite some travesty that the other side did, which is out there on the 2% fringes or whatever, and nobody's talking about being able to unite the country and move forward on things.
Well, that's because look back to the Navalny reaction in Russia, or non-reaction, or tepid reaction. It's people are afraid to talk out. The people in the middle, the moderates, are afraid to call out the people in their own party on the extremes. The moderate Democrats, of course, Fred, I don't know that you'd agree there are any, but I think there are. The moderate Democrats are being afraid to be called out by the progressive radicals, and the right on the Republican, moderate Republicans are, and I believe the majority of Republicans are moderate, are afraid to be called out by, I mean, look what happened to Liz Cheney, who's hardly moderate. She's a conservative, right-wing, rock-ribbed Republican from a long line of them. And she's been drummed out of the party for daring to say the emperor has no clothes.
I think she's a great example to use of what I would counter Fred Levering with on, it's not all at the edges. When I saw her last speaking, I think it was on CNN, she was talking about several of the current issues going on. And when she said it came to the border, she was very clear saying that Joe Biden created a bigger problem there than needed, and nobody knows why. You know, she was very clear in her disagreement with him. And I don't think there are too many Democrats right now who wouldn't listen to Liz Cheney on that and say, you probably have a point.
Indeed.
You know, I think there are a whole lot of Democrats who might say that was an own goal, you know, and continue to be. And why in the world did they drag out so long? So I don't think that there is just this dogmatic response from the Democratic Party to back up everything that's going on. In fact, what we've been talking about in Gaza is showing there is resistance to authority in the head of the party. So I think that the mainstream conservative news stuff is very much about assaults on persons to discredit them over a long period of time. I don't see that was necessarily even needed with the Republicans. I mean, I think that the criteria about talking about Trump is pretty much a factual one. It's not about making stuff up. There's a lot there to run with that's just, you know, awful for in the reality. I don't think we've seen that. We didn't see people taking hits at a lot of the other presidential candidates on that. You know, if they said things that were crazy, they went after that. But for the most part, you know, I think that there was a lot of hope that a Nikki Haley or Chris Christie or whatever might be able to get bigger voice in the Republican Party. And that is the moderate line. That is the centrist line.
Well, I think Nikki Haley's hanging in there. And I don't dislike her at all, don't get me wrong, but I think she's hanging in there in spite of the fact that her odds of winning the nomination are very small, is that Trump implodes with a legal issue, and then she's the last person standing. I mean,
I think you're right. And she's been getting a lot of money lately.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, but no support in any state, really. She doesn't right. have a chance in hell to win even one state.
Well, I'd like her to keep going and saying what she's saying, because I think it needs to be heard. Whether or not it changes votes, she is at least one person bold enough to speak the truth.
Once he's nominated, she will fall back in line.
Indeed.
May well.
Oh, I don't doubt that at all. We can't do it today. We don't have enough time. And next week we're going to have a couple of our panelists out on assignment, so it wouldn't be appropriate then. But I'm thinking that in a couple of weeks here, we ought to of course things can change by then. But let's take a look at these various legal issues that Trump's got, like five trials going or whatever. And think about each one of them individually a little bit. You know, like there is, I think there's a lot more to the story. I'm sorry to get personal here, Fredo, but, you know, you seem to have the attitude that he's indicted on all these things and therefore it's guilty, guilty, guilty. And
no,
there's
a
lot
what I
more
said
subtlety
was,
to this.
He has been found guilty on the
that we're not going to get into it now, but even on those things that he was found guilty, there's details to it. I mean, he was prosecuted and found guilty in New York, where I mean the DA or the attorney general rather ran on the platform of getting Trump. I mean, so you know, I think there's been government used here, in weaponized or whatever the right word is in some senses. But so in a couple of weeks when we have the whole team together, we're going to get into some of that stuff. So we'll see how that goes. Now, in our remaining couple of minutes here, I would like to...
Be careful what you wish for, Fred.
Well, but it needs to be done. You have to have the... Martha, you have to have the courage to do what's right, and you know.
Indeed.
We need to discuss that.
Been weaponized.
You all big dasher, Joshua.
Well, see, here we go. You can tell that's going to be a fun session. So, but let's end up here with a couple of other sorts of issues locally here in the schools department. I saw that Reading A High and their new STEM high school that is going to be built soon is going to include a section for lack of better words, homeless kids that They might have a place to sleep at night, but they don't have a place to study, and then they, you know, take a shower and get ready for the school day and stuff like that. And they're going to add a facility at Reading High in the built somewhere in the campus, as well as in that new building, to accommodate that. Any thoughts from the panel? One seems like a good idea to me, but
I think it's a good idea. It would be interesting to have some statistics about. I mean, we're talking about 15 kids, are we talking about 100 kids?
No. I like to look for statistics, but there are far more than that homeless kids in every school district in Berks County. Wow. And to call them homeless is a very definite legal term that the state has defined. These are the kids who are couch surfing. These are the kids who don't have a permanent address. They may be living with their grandparents part-time. But yeah, I think it's going to hold a lot more kids.
It'd be great if we could have a guest that knows this situation.
Well, that's a good point. So it's we agree it's a positive thing. The other thing about schools is the situation down in the Antietam School District seems to be getting sorted out, that there's some cooperation now going on between Mount Penn Borough and inspection requirements and traffic study requirements and so on, that they're going to try to expedite things to get the kids out from behind their computer screens and into a classroom setting, which I think is a great thing. And I frankly know some of those people involved, and I'm not surprised that they've come to work something out. The other thing I wanted to just mention now as we hit our last minute or two is I read a thing back in, 79 AD, Mount Vesuvius went off and buried Pompeii and a neighboring town called Herculum. And in Herculum, they found some scrolls, that the way they used to write things and keep them in libraries and so on back in those days. And they were embedded in this volcanic ash and everything and lava and whatnot. And they couldn't do anything with them, but they knew they were scrolls. But somehow with artificial intelligence, they've been able to begin to decipher those things and read them, even though they're wound up and were buried in lava. I mean, it's a remarkable thing. So we sometimes worry about artificial intelligence, and it's going to put all of us out of work here on BCTV someday. But in the meantime, there are positive things. I mean, that's an amazing thing to me. I can't quite understand how that can happen. But did you any of you see that thing? We're just about, unfortunately, out of town. But
no, I didn't.
Well, having said that and left a mystery hanging as to how the heck it works, maybe we'll find out something. So I want to thank the panel for your insightful comments today. Audience, thank you for joining us. We hope we've added something to your day. And we look forward to seeing you next time. So goodbye till next week.
Bye-bye.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.